Ladies and gentlemen, as the world progresses rapidly towards digitization in all forms of life, media too has undergone a substantial change. But does this evolution also reflect on the educational framework in this country? Our next panel discusses the theme of media education back then and now. To chair the panel, I'd like to call upon Mr. Tarun Nangia, Associate Editor at NewsX, to kindly join me on stage. Can we have a big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen? I would request everybody to please settle down and maintain silence. Joining him on the stage to debate the motion, please welcome Professor Sanjeev Banavat, former head, Center for Mass Communication, University of Rajasthan. Professor Divakar Shukla, Director, Jagran School of Journalism and Communication, Jagran Lake City University. Dr. Meera Desai, Professor in Communication Technology and HOD, SNDTWU, Department of Extension Education. And the previous two panelists who were delayed, Professor B.P. Sanjay, Pro Vice Chancellor, Tamil Nadu University, and Professor C.B. Patnaik, Director, Institute of Knowledge, Societies, and Centurion University, Bhubaneswar. Can we have a round of applause for all our panelists, ladies and gentlemen, please?
Then you can do it, because they've asked me to fill. No, they don't think they have. You have to ask him.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. I'd hand over to the panel chair.
Good afternoon, everyone, and I would like to welcome my panel and welcome all of you for this afternoon today. There is always an inherent risk in chairing a session which is a pre-lunch session, because most of the people in the audience as well as my panelists look forward to their lunch eagerly, but we have a schedule and we have to keep that schedule. So I would like to start by first welcoming my panel for this afternoon. And So since we are running short on time and we have just about 30-31 minutes to finish this panel, we want to get to the brass tacks really, and I would like request my panelists to speak one after one. But I'd like to lay the ground for this discussion. A lot has been said since today morning on the state of media education. But it is also said that when standards decline in society, they decline for every field and every vocation and profession. Media is not something which is out of the box. So when a lot of people say the media has gone down, well, the whole society went down. Look at what our universities were, be the Allahabad University, the Pune University, or the University in Baroda, all those things. And Infosys, I read an interview of Narayan Murthy around 12 years ago. They set up a center of learning in Bangalore. Many people in the audience would know about this center. And we in the media went to interview Mr. Murthy, and we asked him that, why are you setting up a center of learning? You already hire engineers who pay a lot of heavy fees to get graduated, and then you hire them. So Mr. Murthy then had said that we couldn't bother less if these were engineers or no. If even these boys were 12th pass boys, we would have recruited, trained them for our needs, because what they are being taught is so outdated that any which ways we train them, put them through a 1 year course. And now in this Bangalore center, we hire fresh engineers, put them through a course, pay them stipend, and then skill them for our purpose. Juxtapose this with the news media today. What is happening? A whole new meaning has been given to the term learn, unlearn, and relearn. Learn in the media school. The first thing when you step into office, the first day is you have to unlearn. Your boss will tell you, okay, wo sab bhul jao, abhi kaam aise hota hai. You're taught that. And then relearn the ways of the working world. This actually tells you about the mismatch between academia and the industry. Laying this ground, I would now request my panelists one by one to lay down the ground. We would go left to right, my left to right. Sir, if you may please introduce yourself and then share your comments.
Oh, okay, my name is Divakar Shukla, and I work with the Jagannath School of Journalism and Communication at Jagannath Lake City University. That's in Bhopal. Background is that, since this is a very illustrious gathering, not only of the speakers, but also possibly of the audiences. Most of you are highly proficient in terms of academics, and you come from done your researches and a whole lot of things, and then come into education in terms of teaching. There are lots of professionals, I'm pretty sure, who have, after profession, getting into the work stream and then got back into the universities and teaching. So I'm also part of the second lot, which is essentially I worked a lot of times in the industry, in a diverse industries, worked in the social sector with the World Bank, worked with European Union, actually, a commission at that point of time. And then I worked for a long years with Ogilvy and Mather, which was an advertising agency. But I used to specialize in communication and strategies. And at that point of time, as always happens with all of us, as you know, people who are working, that is, you called over the weekends to do some lecturing, some guest lectures, so to say. And as time passed, I realized that, and something which we were talking in the morning as a part of a panel, that there is a slight difference between the praxis and the theory. Not too much of a difference, but I think it's a question of a deployment. Theories come out of the practice, and eventually if we lost the big compass that why the theories are there, then eventually the theories start becoming irrelevant. And that's where the industry would start telling you, I mean, whatever you teach in the universities is not relevant to us. So somewhere this was a kind of a challenge and dilemma and thoughts which used to get. So I said, let me take a complete, you know, break from the corporate world and from the industry and start working in the university. And I'm very happy that Professor Ranade is also here, because he was part of a university there. And why I took his name is not because of the fact that he's there and I've known him, but something which is part of the session that we are going to have, and I won't take much time. I'll just put up a couple of points and then everybody can take it forward. You know, the question was the media education then and now. So I was wondering, what does it mean? What is the imperative behind this then and now? Where I realize it is more of a question of how and why. The world has changed, and eventually we realize in universities and academicians, we often, you know, lose the sight of the fact that when we tell our students also that, you know, you are ready for the complex world, you'll succeed, and so what? But the fact is, any curriculum in the media education has to be enlightening, has to make them inspired and aware media professionals. Problem is that a lot of journalists and a lot of advertising professionals as well, I'm taking a broader view to it, they know about media, they know about the nuances of writing 5 W's and H and whole lot of things that come into play, but they really don't know that journalism and communication and media works in a society. So there was a question which Vikram and somebody else raised this. He said that we are not learning, we're not reading. So how do we teach media and journalism and advertising to students? I mean, when I say students, I'm not thinking in a cynical way. I'm talking about ourselves as people who are teaching. We never realize the fact that they should be learning the tricks of the trade, reading literature. And a lot of, I know, professors are trying to do that. And recently I was talking to a student who's specializing in Hindi journalism. Hindi journalism, so I asked him casually, have you read Raag Darbari? Because Raag Darbari is a very seminal work in Hindi literature. Satire, 50 years completion. I said, have you read Raag Darbari? So he said, no. Then eventually I pushed another student to asking, have you read Raag Darbari? And that student was good. She said, sir, I've read Raag Darbari, but translated version by Gillian Wright. I've not read it in Hindi. How many of you not read Raag Darbari, you will never understand the nuances and dynamics of an Indian village in North India. Now, how do you do journalism in North India, in the village, until unless you know the nuances of it? So my point is, and that's where I raise the case, is that it's not a question of the theories being right or wrong, what was there, and we are not romanticizing the past as well. What I'm trying to convey is, I think the context has changed, so should be the universities and professors and academician as well as the scholars. We need to understand the dynamics are different, contexts are different. We just need to tweak ourselves from that particular perspective. If you are able to do that, I think we'll again become very, very relevant, including the education part of it. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Shukla, for sharing your experience and your opinion with us. I'll go to Professor Sanjeev Banavat. And sir, I would like you to first introduce yourself and then share your opinions on this subject.
नहीं मैंने भी इनसे ये कहा था लेकिन ये कह रहे हैं कि रिकॉर्डिंग हो रही है इसलिए जरूरी है मैंने कहा दो मिनट तो उसी में निकल जाएंगे मेरा नाम प्रोफेसर संजीव भानावत और राजस्थान विश्वविद्यालय में लगभग 4 दशक तक सेवा करने के बाद वहाँ से सेवानिवृत्ति हुई है और पत्रकारिता से संबंधित लगभग 30 पुस्तकों का लेखन संपादन किया और पिछले लगभग 2.5 दशक से एक मीडिया जर्नल त्रैमासिक कम्युनिकेशन टुडे द्विभाषी पत्र है, इसका मैं संपादन कर रहा हूँ। लगभग चार दशक से आकाशवाणी, दूरदर्शन और जो विभिन्न दूसरे चैनल्स हैं जयपुर, राजस्थान और अपने नेशनल, इनके साथ भी किसी न किसी रूप से जुड़ाव रहा है। हालांकि सवेरे से बात बहुत कुछ हो रही है और समय बहुत सीमित है। जैसा सत्र के अध्यक्ष महोदय ने कहा कि प्री लंच सेशन की चुनौतियां हैं, तो पोस्ट लंच सेशन की भी चुनौतियां हैं, है ना। मैं तो कभी कल्पना करता हूँ भोजन के बाद जो सत्र होगा उसकी क्या स्थिति होगी। तो चलिए, इस सारे दौर में जो मुख्य मुद्दे हैं, मीडिया पहले और अब, लगभग एक शताब्दी की यात्रा हो गई है। डॉक्टर एनी बेसेंट ने अदियार यूनिवर्सिटी में जो प्रारंभिक प्रयत्न किए थे, उसके बाद मेरे ख्याल देश के लगभग सभी विश्वविद्यालयों में पत्रकारिता की पढ़ाई किसी न किसी रूप से हो रही है, और जिन हालातों की चर्चा की गई वो हमारे किसी से छिपे नहीं हैं। मुझे जो व्यक्तिगत रूप से कुछ समस्याएं लगती हैं कि सबसे बड़ी चुनौती है टेक्स्ट बुक्स की, विशेषकर अंग्रेजी की बात मैं नहीं कर रहा हूँ, बल्कि अंग्रेजी में भी ज़्यादातर पुस्तकें, कुछ प्रयत्न इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ मास कम्युनिकेशन और किसी दौर में प्रेस इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ इंडिया, वहाँ कुछ ऐसी पुस्तकें प्रकाशित की गई थी जिस समय हम लोगों ने पत्रकारिता की पढ़ाई की थी, उस समय हमारे लिए कुछ उपयोगी थी। लेकिन अब वो पुस्तकें लगभग बेमानी हो गई हैं, जहाँ सवेरे हम मोबाइल खरीदते हैं, शाम तक ये पीड़ा होती है मन में कि काश कुछ घंटे और प्रतीक्षा कर लेते, एक नई टेक्नोलॉजी वाला मोबाइल मिल जाता। तो जहाँ जिस तेज़ी से ये तकनीकी बदलाव हो रहा है, उसके साथ कैसे जुड़ करके हम हमारी मीडिया शिक्षा को जोड़ पाएंगे। चूँकि राजस्थान में पत्रकारिता शिक्षा की एक तरह से शुरुआत करने का सौभाग्य अवसर मुझे मिला, उस सरकारी सिस्टम में जितनी प्रशासनिक और वित्तीय यंत्रणाएं भुगतनी पड़ती हैं, मुझे लगता है कि बात खूब हुई कि तकनीक हो गई है, UGC पैसा दे रही है, स्टूडियो बन गए, लैब्स बन गए, ये सब हो गया। और जब इक्विपमेंट्स का ऑर्डर करते हैं, जब तक वो इंस्टॉल होते हैं, तब तक वो इस मीडिया की दुनिया से बिल्कुल एब्सोल्यूट हो चुके होते हैं, बेमानी हो चुके होते हैं। इन सारे तकनीकी दृष्टि से समृद्ध विभागों के बावजूद जो चुनौती है, वो है उनके संचालन के लिए हमारे पास उस तरह के अनुभवी ट्रेनर, प्रशिक्षक मिल पाएं, ये दूसरी बड़ी चुनौती है। अंततः हमको निर्भर रहना पड़ता है उन्हीं प्रोफेशन में जो लोग काम कर रहे हैं, वो अपनी समय के हिसाब से, सुविधा के हिसाब से वहाँ आते हैं। तो टेक्स्ट बुक्स की समस्या, उन तकनीकी सुविधाओं की क्षमता का पूरा उपयोग कर सकने की दूसरी चुनौती। तीसरी चुनौती मुझे लगती है कि हमारे यहाँ जर्नल्स का भारी अभाव है। सवेरे बात आई थी, कुछ विदेशी जर्नल्स के नाम लिए गए, लेकिन भारतीय परिदृश्य में जिस तरह के जर्नल्स, अंग्रेजी में तो फिर भी कुछ प्रकाशन हो रहे हैं, लेकिन हिंदी और भारतीय भाषाओं के जो विद्यार्थी हैं, उनके लिए मुझे लगता है अपने शोध पत्रों का प्रकाशन करने की एक बहुत बड़ी चुनौती बनी हुई है। इस कारण से इस क्षेत्र में, क्योंकि डिसिप्लिन यह है जो अभी कुछ वर्षों पूर्व एक तरह से विकसित होने लगा है, एक डिसिप्लिन के रूप में इसको स्वीकार करने के लिए प्रयत्न भी अलग अलग विश्वविद्यालयों में। अच्छा, ये एक अलग चुनौती और है कि अलग अलग विश्वविद्यालयों में जर्नलिज्म को कहीं तो लिया गया है सोशल साइंस फैकल्टी के साथ, कहीं लिया गया है आर्ट्स फैकल्टी के साथ, कुछ विश्वविद्यालयों में दो तीन शिक्षक हैं वहाँ भी एक अलग से फैकल्टी कम्युनिकेशन की बना दी गई है। तो ये सारी चुनौतियाँ हैं कि एक डिसिप्लिन के रूप में अभी तक उस तरह की मान्यता इसको नहीं मिल पाई है जो मान्यता हमारे दूसरे विषयों को मिल पाई है। जब सुरभि से मेरी बात हो रही थी मीडिया डायरेक्टरी के संदर्भ में, तब मैंने भी ये कहा था, बहुत समय से एक मन में पीड़ा है, जिस तरह से पॉलिटिकल साइंस, सोशियोलॉजी, कॉमर्स, ये इस तरह के विषय जो हैं, इनके लगातार हर वर्ष नियमित रूप से इस तरह के सम्मेलन किए जाते हैं, लेकिन जर्नलिज्म में छुटपुट प्रयत्न, मैंने 3 बार ऑल इंडिया मीडिया एजुकेटर कॉन्फ्रेंस की, अभी भुवनेश्वर में मीडिया एनक्लेव हो रहा है, अभी अनुराग जी के नेतृत्व में ये सारा आयोजन किया गया, छुटपुट प्रयत्न अलग अलग जगह से हो रहे हैं, लेकिन एक विषय के रूप में जहाँ विश्वविद्यालय सभी शिक्षकों को आमंत्रित करके एक नियमित रूप से इस तरह का एक संगठनात्मक स्तर पर कहीं बैठ करके विचार किया जा सके अपने विषय की चुनौतियों को लेकर के, इस तरह की संभावनाओं की आवश्यकता है, एक ऐसा सब्जेक्ट एसोसिएशन बन पाए जो उस दिशा में काम कर सके। जो हमारे मीडिया काउंसिल की बात की गई, मुझे पता नहीं मीडिया काउंसिल तो कितना क्या कर पाएगी, लेकिन जिस तरह से UGC या AICT जो हैं हमारे, जो इस तरह की मॉनिटरिंग बॉडीज़ हैं, वैसी कहीं कोई बॉडी बन पाए और उनको क्रियान्वित करने के लिए विश्वविद्यालय पर ये मैंडेटरी हो कि इस तरह कोई भी विभाग शुरू करने के पहले, क्योंकि मुझे बहुत मौका मिला है, चाहे UGC कमेटीज़ हों, चाहे हमारे राजस्थान में कम से कम इतने निजी विश्वविद्यालय खुले, 20-25 की कमेटियों में रहा, तो जिस तरह की स्थितियाँ हैं, जो जितनी AICT और इन जो मैंडेटरी बार काउंसिल ऑफ इंडिया, उसकी एक धमकी ने हमारे विश्वविद्यालय में 20 शिक्षकों की नियुक्तियाँ करवा दी लॉ के अंदर। तो जब तक इस प्रकार की एक बॉडीज हमारे यहाँ डेवलप नहीं होंगी, तब तक ये फैकल्टी की चुनौतियाँ, मैंने 28 साल तक अकेले डिपार्टमेंट चलाया, उसके बाद विश्वविद्यालय बंद हो गया, पत्रकारिता का हमारे यहाँ पर, वो सारे शिक्षक मेरे को ट्रांसफर कर दिए गए, समुद्र को लाके नदी में मिला दिया गया। तो इतनी सारी चुनौतियाँ अलग अलग क्षेत्रों में हैं, तो मुझे लगता है कि उस भाषाई क्षेत्र की जो चुनौतियाँ हैं उनको ध्यान में रखते हुए जो हमारी स्थानीय भाषा है उसमें किस तरह से हम शिक्षण प्रशिक्षण कर पाते हैं, टेक्स्ट बुक्स, फैकल्टी, फिर एक जो डिजिटल जिस तरह से शुरू हुआ है माध्यम, समझ जाए मुझे बता दीजिएगा, डिजिटल माध्यम जिस तरह से हुआ है, क्योंकि मुझे किसी ने पूछा कि आपको भाषण के लिए बुलाना चाहते हैं कितना समय चाहिए, मैंने कहा 5 मिनट बोलना है तो कम से कम 1 महीना पहले बताना, 15 मिनट बोलना है तो 15 दिन पहले बताना, बोलते ही रहना है तो अभी चलने को तैयार हो। और विधिवत रूप से विषय की सूचना मुझे कल ही मिली है कि किस विषय में कौन से सत्र में बोलना है, है ना। और शिक्षक तो 1 घंटे से पहले क्लास छोड़ता नहीं है, और यहाँ 6 महीने हो गए क्लास लिए मेरे सेवानिवृत्ति के बाद, तो बहुत सारी चीज़ें दिमाग में उठ रही हैं, तो इसलिए अध्यक्ष जो सत्र के हैं उनके पास समय रूपी अंकुश है ना, लेकिन उधर रेडियो और टेलीविज़न आपने बिल्कुल 5 मिनट में समय वक्तव्य समाप्त कर दिया, मैंने आपसे कहा 4 मिनट हो गए, 5 मिनट वक्तव्य के समाप्त, जैसे ही 5 मिनट आप मुझे बता दीजिएगा। वैसे लास्ट बात मुझे कहनी है कि डिजिटल डिवाइस जिस तरह से शुरू हुई है इसका भी शिक्षण प्रशिक्षण में प्रभावी उपयोग की संभावनाएं हैं। UGC ने MOOC और स्वयं और जिस तरह के शुरू किए हैं वहाँ वीडियो लेक्चर्स के माध्यम से, केवल हम एक उसका एक जो कहना चाहिए कि उस माहौल का एक परिचय करा सकते हैं, अल्टीमेटली तो जब वहाँ जाएंगे तभी वो सीख पाएंगे, नहीं तो वही स्थिति होगी। दिल्ली में कार ड्राइवर का एक्सीडेंट हो गया, उससे पूछा ड्राइविंग कहाँ से सीखी थी, उसने कहा कॉरेस्पॉन्डेंस स्कूल से सीखी थी। ऐसे माहौल में जब इस तरह की व्यवस्थाएं हैं उसमें कितना व्यावहारिक प्रशिक्षण आने वाले समय की जो तकनीकी चुनौतियां हैं उसका सामना कर सकने वाले मीडिया कर्मी हमारे पास तैयार हो पाए। एक जो मुझे अक्सर बात पीड़ा करती है, रोजगार की हम बात करते हैं, क्या उस रोजगार के साथ कहीं हम ये बात भी कर सकते हैं वैल्यू बेस्ड एजुकेशन की? आपके पास सारे के सारे जो कोर्सेज हैं वो जॉब ओरिएंटेड के नाम पे हम शुरू कर रहे हैं, जो हमारे ह्यूमैनिटीज जो सब्जेक्ट्स हैं उनकी शिक्षण प्रशिक्षण व्यवस्था क्या की जाएगी, ताकि जिस आस्थाओं की, भावनाओं की या मूल्यों की हम बात करते हैं वो इस शिक्षण के साथ जुड़े, ताकि जो चिंताएं आप मीडिया के परिप्रेक्ष्य में यहाँ प्रकट कर रहे हैं शायद एक सीमा तक उनका भी हम समाधान कर सकें। आपने समय दिया, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद।
थैंक यू। आई वुड लाइक टू थैंक प्रोफेसर भानावत फॉर शेयरिंग हिज एक्सपीरियंस, बट वन कॉमेंट मेड बाय हिम विच स्टूड आउट दैट फॉर 28 ईयर्स ही रैन अ डिपार्टमेंट with a single person. Anybody in a Western university would be shocked that this happens in India. A single man runs the whole department. Students are enrolled, they get educated. But since we are short of time, I'll go to Dr. Meera Desai. And ma'am, if you would like to introduce yourself, and also she has a presentation to make very quickly. And ma'am, you said you will stand and would like to make it, please.
No, he's telling me to go there. No, I don't have much of a power, but I have a point to make.
Even if you want to sit and make a presentation, if it's convenient.
Yeah. Thank you so much. I'm a single person department. Just now we were making a mention. So I'm a part of Women's University, and we have a lot of them here who are single people departments. So that's the status of media education actually in our country right now. I just came across this one particular thing which I thought was very exciting, because since morning we are saying things are changing, and I feel nothing much has changed. I'm taking a location that we still are being born and married and making children and doing all sorts of things. So I don't think things are changing dramatically, only the way we are doing things is changing. So probably that's the context that I take. I came across this one particular person in Virginia Island yesterday only, actually, very interestingly, and I thought this is kind of very appropriate. Secondly, I thought visual, we were talking about visuals. So at some point I thought I'll only talk about visuals and not want to talk about words, but then as teachers, we can't escape, as we all know. When I joined as a media student 30 years back, 1988, I was confused. I was not sure what I wanted to do. What I'm seeing now is the student comes with a very clear goals. So that's the change that I'm noticing. Next. I had all sorts of teachers who came and taught me, like sociologists, political scientists, anthropologists. What I'm now seeing is the kind of teachers that I, as a teacher educator or teacher administrator, I'm giving my students are not that dynamic, honestly. I'm kind of pretty pained about them, because I look at them as sunflowers, because they look at what needs to be told rather than what should be told. So a lot of times the problem I have is that they play to the gallery rather than what they should be doing as a teacher. So that's kind of one concern that I have. Next. When I was taught, the syllabus that I had was kind of anything and everything. What is increasingly now happening is that, and we are aware with the private institutes, that the teacher is setting the syllabus, the teacher is taking the class, teacher is doing assessment, and the student is out. So we are not, what kind of education that we are creating? I have kind of one question that I have. Next. Just do next. So right now, as we all are aware, and I think most of you are aware of the fact that we have all sorts of kind of people doing media education, because my context was that we have public universities and we have all sorts of kind of institutions that are kind of offering education. Sorry, sitting here. Next. Yeah, I think your frame is breaking. Next. You'll have to just do next, because I'd assumed that I'll have a power to control my PowerPoint, which I don't have. Just do next quickly. What I have noticed as a, because it's been about 10 years, if you Google Meera Desai SNDT, I have done kind of last 10 years, lot of research on media education itself. And what kind of personally I feel is that, when we talk about different aspects of media practice, next, you will realize that we don't have much of planning, strategizing being taught. We don't have much of creative execution being taught. So most of us who are kind of were in practice and landed up in teaching, or those who are kind of in teaching directly without having any media experience, they've all done it by kind of experimentation. And as since morning, we are seeing a lot of people have kind of by accident landed up into media education. So that's a kind of another challenge, because there's no pedagogy of media education that we can kind of very confidently talk about. Next. So there is a kind of a shift that we notice. I have a kind of a problem here, because since morning we're talking about media education as a kind of open-ended thing. You will realize that there are a lot of variables to a kind of a pedagogy in that sense of the term. And a lot of times we look at this as a kind of a carrot to a student who comes into our institutions, and we say that you will get a kind of very good job. And we also do examination, which is like a balloon, because I'm not sure, because all the media practitioners are saying that the kind of students that we are training are not kind of good enough. I have kind of serious doubts, because a lot of us landed up 30 years back as the same students that now kind of claim and talk about how media education should be. So that's a kind of a complexity and paradox. And then when we talk about a kind of a degree, there is no monitoring at all in terms of, because the student that I'm giving a first class is not getting first class in kind of media practice, or there is a media practice where the employer is very happy, but I was very disappointed with that student. So there is no kind of a consistency of assessment that I am noticing. Next. What I am kind of facing as a media educator for about 20 plus years in kind of a university is that what will we teach and how much will we teach? Because we all kind of ideally know a student who needs to do everything, know everything, should have an idea who is a vice president of India, at the same time also should know how to operate a camera. Now, is it kind of possible? It's kind of pretty complex and very ambitious in that sense. So these are some of my challenges I feel is, and what Banavaji also talked about, this technological upgradation of classrooms and all that. And then when I am kind of facing it as a media educator and a media education administrator, what I have realized is that there are kind of problems in terms of the motivations of the teacher and the student, because a lot of people said in the morning also that good editors doesn't know how to teach editing. Bhatraji said we want people with spine so that they'll not crawl, but we see a lot of people crawling rather than having a spine. So how do we kind of, is there a measurement? There is no thermometer to measure whether the person has a spine or not. So that's the kind of problem that we all need to kind of recognize. And also the learner diversity in classroom is extreme in my 30 years of experience, because I am getting all sorts of students in my classroom who would never come into a higher education system in our country. So that's kind of a complex problem I have, because I have a student who is 24/7 online, and I have a student who is not having a mobile phone, actually, honestly. When I'm saying that, I recognize that the data pack is expensive, and she says that I cannot, I have only incoming and I cannot call you. So that's a real, I don't think the India that we all are aware of is India there in that sense of the term. Next. So broadly, the point that I wanted to make was, thank you for your time and attention. We can take this dialogue ahead. But just to kind of put a one-liner in that sense of the term, I feel that something like this in a more conversational, more dialogue, mutual understanding level, if we can kind of make in terms of solutions, because we all are, I think, aware of problems and challenges. What is more critical is to connect hand between media education Dr. and Desai, media practitioners. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for finishing in pretty much in time, and She said that she'll finish it in 5 minutes, and she's done in 5 minutes. I would like to thank her for quickly rushing her through the presentation, but I would like to now welcome Professor Chandrabhanu Patnaik. Sir, if you quickly your introduction as well as your 3 or 4 points that you want to make on the state of education.
Yes, my name is Chandrabhanu Patnaik. Right now I am the director of an institute called the Institute of Knowledge Societies in Bhubaneswar. I have had quite a checkered career, so I shan't go into that. But talking about media education, I've been hearing people talk about the fact that, you know, somehow it was better in the past and it's not so great today. Now, Ivan Illich, many, many years ago, wrote a book called The De-schooling Society. Okay, now most people here talk about learning and unlearning and relearning. When he said, when he talked about de-schooling, it was not about unlearning. It was actually de-schooling. And I think the problem lies there and not with learning. That's one. Number two, I think that I'll give you one or two sort of anecdotes and I'll finish. Today people talk, because of the way that we have created our education system, people are talking about, everywhere I go, people are talking about outcome-based education. Now this is something that really befuddles me, because I don't know what is the outcome of education if it is not education itself. Okay. So therefore I have no clue what is this outcome-based education and what is it that we are trying to achieve or get to. Now, there are also people who talk about technology and especially media technology, new media, social media technology being democratizing. To me, that is also a fallacy. I work essentially with a lot of tribal people in very interior Odisha. Doesn't seem to me that technology of any kind is democratizing. In fact, by the time they get some technology, we have moved ahead. So technology is always hierarchical and it is always non-democratic. Okay, so this is the other thing. The third thing I wanted to say was that in 1973, Mysore University introduced a certificate course in journalism for the first time. I took that course. Many years later, when I came back from traveling all over the world, I went to see what was being taught in journalism and communication schools. It wasn't much different from what I had studied in 1973. What was happening was essentially cosmetic changes. Okay, so I'm not sure how we go about doing this. Now, one more small anecdote and I'll finish. Fred Jameson, some of you may have heard, great guru of postmodernism, was asked that if you had to define postmodernism in one sentence, how would you do it? That's a really tough one. But he came up with a single line definition and he said, it is the acknowledgement of plurality. So if you take that definition, then India, by its very nature, is postmodern because we have nothing but plurality.
Yes.
Right? But when that question was posed to Fred Jameson, he said, he was very angry, he was livid in fact, and he said that you cannot be postmodern until you have been modern. In other words, I have to be like you in order to be like me. I think our whole education system is premised on that. We are trying to be somebody else, trying to take some other theory and try and fit our own data into this and hope, keep our fingers crossed and hope for the best. Okay. Now, just one last thing, which is that reading and we, all our arguments to date is based on the premise of literacy. We have, we are saying that all this theory, all of this media, everything is based on a premise of literacy. If somebody asked who did the printing press actually help? Okay. Certainly not the oral traditions of the world.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Patnaik, for finishing it in time. I would like to go to Professor B.P. Sanjay, former Vice Chancellor, Central University of Tamil Nadu, and a known industry veteran. Sir, your comments on this issue, please.
Thank you, Chair and fellow colleagues. The subject matter seems to be like, you know, old people like us suddenly being asked to be in the world of Twitter. All our experience to be shared in shared or discussed in less than a few minutes, but that's okay, that's challenging, and that's what media is all about. The past, nothing to romanticize about the past except to say that journalism education situated itself in the broad university system, not because the university wanted to open up another discipline called journalism. It wanted to posit its liberal arts institutional framework and situate journalism in the context of the society in which we live. So the first part of the past is actually a saga of university education, its public pressures on resources, etc. And some of my friends here have talked about single person departments, etc. Fortunately, I come from a stream where we are 11 faculty and we have all stream faculty in our university. It's a public funded university. Probably we are blessed, and I've also had an occasion to work with the Indian Institute of Mass Communication, which institutionally has been more blessed than any of the public institutions in the country. The dilemma then and even now, as we heard the panelists, was that there seems to be some kind of a disconnect between the dynamics of what we wish to educate and train and what the industry or the so-called industry captains expect us. And who is an industry captain today is a very difficult question. Was it, are they editors, or are they commercial entrepreneurs, or are they network operators, etc.? We really do not know. But nevertheless, we do accept that there's an industry out there, and for which we are obligated and we are committed to provide human resources. But the challenge came in the 80s and the 90s post-liberalization, when the very same media institutional framework that critiqued and even today criticizes media education set up media institutions as revenue model for their sulking revenues. And this is the paradox of a country like India, where we have seminars decrying public institutions, but upholding some of all values are being imparted in media-backed school. And that's the second dilemma that we are talking about. The third dilemma is, are we trying to catch up on a daily basis? If 7 apps are discovered or applied in every minute, what is the gestation period of a learning of a youth? Can I go to the class and say that, oh, as I came in, a new app has developed, and if I don't teach you that app, the industry will say that you're not aware of this app, then what are you teaching? I think teaching has to be contextualized in the society that we live. India is a big country. We come from different regions. We escape the complete social justice dynamics in the media. Which media in India actually upheld or talked about the social justice dynamics which was churning the society? If media indeed is a watchdog or was a watchdog, it should have shaped the modalities of that particular change. So there are problems with the media as well. And what happens is this tutu maime continues in all seminars. And I think the time has come when one of the panelists suggested, do we sit in dialogue over what we are teaching? What are the shortcomings? What do you want us? That is not possible. It's always saying that universities are bookish and we are practical. I think time has come when you have to seize media as a larger communication process, recognize the power equations that are taking place, negotiate the commercial dynamics of the media and commodification of news, which is masked as journalism. Then it was journalism, today it is commodity and entertainment. Thank you very much.
I would like to thank Professor B.P. Sanjay, Professor C.B. Patnaik, Professor Sanjeev Bhanavat, Professor Divakar Shukla and Dr. Meera Desai for, if I may say, I requested them to put their opinions in very concise format in 4-5 minutes, and I'm so happy all of them complied. In fact, we've been a bit unfair to them. They should have got more time, but this generally happens in events and they have been understanding. I would like to thank each one of the panelists for being so understanding. I would also like to thank Dr. Anurag Batra and Dr. Surbhi Dhaiya for putting up this wonderful panel today. And all the panels that I have been seeing, I've just read the list. And we were sitting in a pre-lunch session, and I think you should all thank us. We've finished in time. And I will hand over the mic to my colleague there on the desk.
Thank you, really. Thank you, delegates. I would request you to stay on stage for a minute. I'd like to call upon Dr. Surbhi Dhaiya, who is the co-convener of today's summit, to please come on stage and present our delegates with a token of our appreciation. Can we have a round of applause for all our delegates, please? Thank you, delegates. Thank you, Dr. Dhaiya. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll now be breaking for a quick lunch, and I will see you back here in the next half an hour to continue this exciting day. Thank you.